Okay, so we will continue with lecture 12 today, which is covering chapter 12 of the book, okay? So it is about mass storage and mass storage related issues like disk, magnetic tapes, and so on. So in a computer system, we have the RAM, which is the primary storage, right? In RAM, we load the programs into RAM and then run the programs from there. But RAM is a volatile storage. When you power off your computer, you lose your data. Plus, the size of RAM is limited, right? You can have 1 gigabyte RAM, but not very large amount of data can be stored in the RAM, right? And data cannot be stored in the RAM permanently. So we need other type of storage. Secondary storage is needed. So magnetic disks, the disks, hard disks that we are using, actually, is a type of secondary storage device, okay? So they make, actually, the bulk of secondary storage that we have in our modern computers. So in the secondary storage, we store the data permanently, okay? The files, the programs can be stored in the secondary storage permanently. We do not lose the data when you power off your power off the computer. But the access to secondary storage is, of course, slow, so we cannot run a program from the secondary storage directly. We have to load the program into memory and run the program from memory, right? Because the CPU cannot directly access the bytes of the secondary storage. It can access the bytes of the RAM directly, and accessing the RAM is much faster, 1,000 times faster than accessing the disk. So we will talk in this lecture about secondary storage and tertiary storage systems. So we will first talk about the secondary storage and magnetic disks. So as we have said, magnetic disks actually are very common as the secondary storage devices. So they have a mechanical part, a set of platters, one or more platters make a disk, and the disk is always spinning, right? And you can read the data while it is spinning. So the rotation speed may change from disk to disk, but it is around 100 rotations per second, or around 3,000, 5,000 rotations per minute. So the rotation speed of the disk affects the rotational latency. If it is spinning faster, then that means the rotational latency will be less, but you have some other delay components when you are accessing the disk. One delay component is the seek time. So basically, you have to move the head to the correct cylinder and read the data from there, okay? The movement of the head to the correct cylinder, to the correct track, actually takes some time. And this makes up the seek time. This is called seek time. It is in the order of 10 milliseconds and so on. And then when the head comes to the correct cylinder, you have to wait until the sector comes under the head from which you will read the data. So this is the rotational latency, okay? So these are the delay components. After you have found the correct sector to read the data from, okay, so you are transferring now the data to the memory. Of course, it cannot happen at once. So the disk bandwidth, a term, disk bandwidth affects how long it will take to transfer the data. Okay, disk bandwidth, for example, 10 megabytes per second or so on, that means you can transfer at most 10 megabytes of data from the disk to the memory, okay? So if the bandwidth is 50 megabytes per second, this is the maximum speed that you can transfer the data from the disk to the memory. So the bandwidth of the disk, okay, the seek time, rotational latency, and so on, all they affect how long it will take to transfer data from the disk to the memory, okay? So basically, the transfer rate is the rate at which the data can flow between the disk drive into computer memory. And these are the parameters that affect the transfer rate, the amount of data that you can transfer from the disk into memory per unit time interval. So you can, usually disks are not removable. You just plug in to the computer and it stays there always. But you can also have some removable disks. You can use those as well. How can we attach a disk to the computer? Disk can be attached to the I/O bus of the computer, but the disk controller is attached there. Then the disk controller can be connected to the rest of the disk, the mechanical part, and the controller there through a separate bus, which is called, for example, ID bus, ATA bus, SATA bus, USB, fiber channel, SCSI bus, and so on. So there are different bus technologies for the disk systems, okay? So you can actually connect several disks to the same bus, disk bus, okay? And that disk bus is further connected to a controller, host controller, which is connected to the I/O bus of the computer, like PCI bus and so on, okay? So the host controller that is controlling the several disks, okay, is connected to the I/O bus of the computer, like the PCI bus that you have in your computer. And host controller is connected to the rest of the disks, okay, to the disks. using a bus like that, okay, SATA bus or SCSI bus and so on. So we have a host controller and IDIS controller. IDIS controller actually resides inside the mechanical device that you buy as the disk, okay? So you, there you have a disk controller. Assume you have both three such disks, okay? You would like, you can connect them to a single host controller with a bus like that. So the, this host controller then connected to the PCI bus of the computer, and the driver can reach the host controller over the PCI bus to actually write to the registers here and so on, okay? So this is the structure of a disk. What we have, a disk consists of one or more platters. Each platter has one or more tracks. So this is a track, for example. We can have other tracks and so on. So inside a platter, we can have thousands of tracks. Each track has is divided into sectors. So this is a sector, this is another sector, and so on. In a track, we can have hundreds of sectors, okay? So we have several platters. We can have in a disk several platters or one platter. So if you consider several platters, okay, the tracks underneath of each other with the same radius make up a cylinder, okay? So this is one cylinder, okay? So other tracks, for example, with the same radius make other cylinders, okay? So in this cylinder, for example, we have three tracks, right? So when you record data to the disk, you can, for example, record the data to this track first and then to that track, and then to that track. That means you are recording the data into one cylinder. After you have finished recording data into that cylinder, you can go ahead and move to the next cylinder and record the data there. The next cylinder can be, for example, consisting of the adjacent tracks to those tracks, okay? So if we would like to read the data or write data to some sector of the disk, for example, this sector of the disk, then what we need to do, we have to first move the arm, okay, that is actually connected to the heads, to the correct cylinder, to the correct track, okay? So when we move the disk head is on that track or cylinder, we select, for example, all of these heads are actually on the same cylinder, right? So inside that cylinder, we have to select from which track we will read the data. So we will, for example, select this track. That means we will read the data from this head. So that head has to wait, or we have to wait until disk rotates and that sector comes under the head, then we read the data, okay? So if you want to read another block which is sitting in some other cylinder, in some other sector, then we have to move the head arm to that cylinder and select the correct track on that cylinder and read the data from that track, okay? So disks is one type of secondary storage media. The other secondary storage media is magnetic tapes. Okay, so magnetic tapes can also be used to store huge amount of data. So the capacity of a magnetic tape can be, for example, around 20 to 200 gigabytes. It was actually a secondary storage medium earlier. Nowadays, you do not use magnetic tapes as secondary storage media. You usually use them as tertiary storage media. So they are, magnetic tapes are no longer online media, okay? Disks are online media where you can store the data. They are always available to you to store files and so on. But magnetic tapes may not be always online, may not be always available for you to store files, okay? So they are actually tertiary devices nowadays, magnetic tapes. So let's look to the properties of magnetic tapes a little bit. So they are nowadays basically used for, mainly used for backup purposes, okay? You backup your data in your hard disk to a magnetic tape and store it there permanently. So storage of infrequently used data can be stored there. And transfer, it can be also used to transfer data between different systems, okay? You just put your data into a magnetic tape, carry the tape to the other location, to remote location, and transfer the data to another system there. So the access time to magnetic tapes is quite slow, okay, much slower than accessing the disk, especially the random access, okay? It is in the order of 1,000 times slower than the disk, okay? You cannot jump easily to an arbitrary location in the magnetic tape and start reading from there. Random access is very slow, okay? But once you have found the correct location in the magnetic tape, then transferring the data from there is quite fast, okay? So the sequential speed, sequential reading speed, okay, transfer rate of magnetic tape can be as fast as the transfer rate of the disk once you have found the correct location from where you will read the data, okay? So let's turn back to the disk again, to this discussion. So nowadays, what you should visualize the disk is, you should visualize the disk as a one-dimensional array of logical blocks, okay? So disk drives are addressed as a large one-dimensional array of logical blocks, where the block, each block can be one sector or two sectors or four sectors, depending on the system. So the logical block is the smallest unit of transfer. You cannot transfer data less than one logical block, okay? Whenever you would like to transfer something to the disk or from the disk, it has to be at least one block size, okay? Even though you would like to transfer 3 bytes, you have to put it into a block and transfer the whole block to the disk. Or even though you would just read 3 bytes, you have to bring the whole block from the disk containing those 3 bytes and then extract the 3 bytes from that block, okay? So operations to the disk and from the disk always happening in terms of blocks. You write one block at least or read one block at least and so on. So this one-dimensional array of logical blocks is mapped to the physical sectors of the disk sequentially. A simple mapping can be done there. So for example, the block 0 can be stored in sector 0. Block 1 can be stored in sector 1 and so on. So the blocks can be mapped to the sectors in this order. First, you, for example, assume we have 3 platters in the disk. So each platter has tracks, one inside another, okay? So each platter may have, for example, 10,000 tracks. So what you do, you first store data in the outermost track, okay? So this sector of the outermost track can be, for example, the first sector, okay? Sector 0. You start putting your data or putting your blocks to there, and you put your blocks like that. When you have finished putting the blocks into track, into this outermost track, then you jump to the second platter. That means you are still inside the same cylinder, okay? And you use you those sectors in that outermost cylinder in this platter to put the other blocks and so on, okay? So block 0 will be here, block 1, block 2, and so on, block n, and then you jump to here, block n plus 1 is put here, and so on, and block 2n plus 1 is put here, and so on, okay? So when you have finished putting the blocks into the outermost cylinder, then you actually start putting the blocks in the next cylinder, okay? Which is consisting of the tracks aligned together so that those tracks are adjacent to the previous tracks that you have used in each platter. So you first put your data into that track and then that track and so on. Okay, so then you can put the data in the cylinders one by one. Okay, so that means you are actually arranging your logical blocks into the physical disk in this way with a simple mapping. Okay. So how can we attach the disks to computer? If you want to actually access a disk content, which can store several files, lots of files, assume you would like to access those files, how can you access that? You can attach the disk locally to your computer. This is called host attachment. Or you can put the disk in a remote location. There are such disks that can be accessed remotely, okay? You can just buy a box that implements a remote disk, and then you can connect to that disk over the network remotely and access the files sitting there also. So this is called network attachment. So first look to the host attachment. So host attached storage is accessed through I/O ports talking to the I/O buses. So if you attach the disk to your computer locally, then that means you are talking to the disk controller and so on over the I/O bus of the computer. So the disk can be connected to a bus technology like IDE, SCSI, fiber channel and so on. So these may be the technologies that are used to attach the disk to your computer. SCSI, for example, is a technology that can be used to attach disks to a computer. It itself is a bus. Up to 16 SCSI disks can be connected to a SCSI bus. And that SCSI bus is connected to a SCSI initiator, which is connected to the rest of the system, basically to the PCI bus, like here, for example. In the computer, you have a main bus, I/O bus, PCI bus, for example, okay? And CPU can, for example, use that bus to talk to the devices, memory, okay? So several devices may be connected to the PCI bus, and data can be transferred between those devices and memory, okay, over the PCI bus. So you can have, for example, graphics card, you can have network card, you can have wireless card, and so on, okay, that are connected to the PCI card. In your computer, you have PCI slots into which you can connect a network card, Ethernet card, or a wireless card, okay, then that means the driver can move the data between the main memory of the computer and those devices, controllers, using the PCI bus. This is the main bus of your computer, I/O bus. So you can connect to that bus a SCSI host adapter, which is also called SCSI initiator, okay, a card that's connected to the PCI bus. So that will be act as a bridge between the PCI bus and the disk bus, which is the SCSI bus, okay? So into the SCSI bus, you can now connect several disks, okay? Each disk will have a mechanical part and also a controller, okay? Which is called, for example, SCSI target, all right? Or disk controller here. So we have a host controller and several disk controllers to which the host controller can reach over the SCSI bus. The host controller is talking to those targets using a specific protocol which is called SCSI protocol, okay? And your driver, for example, this driver can talk to the SCSI host adapter. It can write into registers here, can read the buffers here, and so on. When it, for example, issues a command to here, then the SCSI initiator will actually issue a SCSI command to the respective disk to read the data or write the data into disk, okay? So this is how you can attach, for example, some SCSI disks to your computer, okay? You can attach those disks to a SCSI bus, and which is connected to a SCSI initiator. So the SCSI initiator is connected to the PCI bus, okay? So this is one way of attaching storage to the computer. The other way of attaching storage to the computer is remote attachment. Network attached storage can be implemented. So then the storage device is made available over a network, rather than connecting directly to the PCI bus or to a SCSI bus, okay? So the disk can be sitting in a remote location, okay? So there are some disks like that, which can be sitting as standalone devices, boxes, okay? Which is connected to Ethernet or to some other networking technology, okay? Then you can access from your PC or from another client computer to that disk remotely. For that, you have to use some protocols, distributed file system protocols like NFS, Network File System Protocol, or CIFS, okay? So these are the common protocols you used for network attached storage. We use those protocols to access the remote storage that is connected to a network, okay? So these, for example, protocols, distributed file system protocols, are implemented using the networking APIs. They can be implemented sockets, but they are usually implemented using RPCs, remote procedures calls, okay? NFS is usually, for example, RPCs, to actually access the file system sitting remotely, okay? So if you would like to open a file or read or write to the file, then a remote procedure call is invoked. That means a procedure is invoked at this host that has to be executed remotely. So a message is sent to the remote disk, and that message includes the name of the function, for example, the read function, okay, including parameters of that and so on, and that remote function is executed in that remote storage unit to read the file sitting there, and the result is returned back to the computer that would like to access the disk remotely, okay? So NFS is not the only way to access remote media and the file sitting there. Other protocols can be used. For example, iSCSI is a protocol that is actually running the SCSI protocol, not over the SCSI cable, but over the IP network. Here you can run, as I said earlier, a SCSI protocol set of messages, command messages and reply messages between the SCSI adapter here and the SCSI controller here, okay? So just you can put a network here. Instead of a SCSI cable, you can have a network here so that now your host computer, your PC, is talking to a disk that is connected, that is sitting actually at a remote location and connected to a network, okay? Then you can send the SCSI commands over a network. So that network can be implementing, for example, TCP/IP protocols. So that means you are now running the SCSI protocol over such a network, for example, TCP/IP network, okay? So that SCSI specification is called iSCSI, okay? So this is how we can attach network-attached storage. So these can be storage boxes that contain disks and necessary protocols like NFS or iSCSI protocols, Excel, and so on, to serve the files sitting there, okay? So you run a distributed file system server, NFS server here, that can serve the files sitting on this disk, okay? So here we can have several PCs. Each PC may mount the file system sitting there to its own local directory tree, so that now it can start accessing the files there, okay? So you can mount the files sitting there the file system there into your local tree, and you can access the files there using the NFS protocol. So then you can, the client process here do not have to be aware of this, okay? They can just open the file, read the file, write into a file, close the file. All operations are actually done remotely over that disk thing here, but the processes are not aware of that, okay? You are just manipulating and using the files as if you are utilizing and using the local files, okay? After you mount the remote file system. So the network here can be any network. For example, the Ethernet network that you are using in your dormitories, okay? It can be a wireless LAN network. But over such a physical network, we run TCP/IP, right? TCP/IP protocols, if you have taken the networking course, you know them. So over that, we run the NFS protocol, okay? So this can be a TCP/IP local area or wide area network. So this is called network attached storage. Another storage area networking is SANs, okay? Storage area networking, this is a different configuration now. What we have here is, now the storage devices and servers that are utilizing them are connected together using a special network. Not a general purpose network like this, okay? In your dormitory, in Ethernet, you can run any application, right? All the traffic is going over a general purpose network in your dormitory, in your Ethernet network, right? But what you can do is that you can actually establish a special network, which is called storage area network, between the storage devices and some servers that are using them, okay? So then this network will just transport, carry disk traffic, file traffic, okay? Not any other traffic, like, for example, web traffic, like, for example, any internet application that you are using, okay? Peer-to-peer traffic and so on, okay? It will not carry them, but it will just carry the disk traffic. In this way, you are isolating the disk traffic into that network, okay? So any other applications will use the other network, your local area network in your dormitory or wide area network, internet. So you can have PCs connect to the local area network, which are connected to the servers. So the PCs can be connected to the internet at some point, so they can, you can run lots of internet applications that are using this network, okay? But if you are using some files and so on from the file server here, okay, then that file server is accessing, for example, the disk, okay, disk content over a special network, so that this traffic is not actually consuming bandwidth of the general purpose network, okay? So this is called storage area networking, and the technology to implement the storage area networking can be different than the Ethernet technology. So there is, for example, one such technology called fiber channel, okay? So fiber channel can be implemented to connect, for example, several storage units and computers that would like to use those storage units together. So fiber channel can be used to connect them together so that you have a storage area network among these storage devices and the servers that are using those storage devices. So this is another way of accessing these disks sitting somewhere in the building, for example, okay? Any questions? All right. So let's look to another issue that the operating system is involved with, disk scheduling. So the operating system has to access the components as fast as possible, including the disk, okay? The performance is very important. How we can access the disk as fast as possible? The operating system actually can do something in that issue. So what does the commands look like that the operating system is sending to the disk controller? The operating system is not telling, for example, to the disk controller, give me that file, write into this file, okay, open this file and so on. These are not the type of commands the OS is sending to the disk controller, right? The type of commands the OS is sending to the disk controller is like what? Give me this block, okay? Read this block X, write into this block X, where X is a block number, okay? These are the type of commands that the disk driver, the operating system is actually telling to the disk controller, okay? So assume now the disk controller is the hardware, right, into which the system software OS is talking to, and the hardware that disk controller is going to the mechanical disk and taking the block, okay, and giving it to the system, right? So now the OS is just specifying a disk block number. So now assume you would like to get several blocks, retrieve several blocks. You would like to get block 70 and then block 200 and then block 300 and so on. That means you give such commands to the disk controller. And then this controller is responsible to go to move the head to the correct position on the disk and retrieve the blocks. Okay? If those blocks that you would like to retrieve are close to each other, that means you can move the head to the correct location and then you can immediately start reading the blocks. But if they are sitting on the physical disk on separate places, then you move the disk head to that place and read the block, and then you move the head to another place, a distant place, another cylinder, and then you move the head to another cylinder and so on, and this will take more time, right? Because moving the head, disk head, to an arbitrary cylinder takes some time, depending how many cylinders you travel. Okay? Traveling from one cylinder to another takes time in the order of milliseconds, which is quite a long time. Okay? So what we can do is actually we can schedule the requests. We can decide on an order how we will serve the requests. Okay? How the disk controller should serve the requests that has to be satisfied. The operating system actually would like to retrieve some blocks, right? Which blocks? The blocks that the application would like to get. Okay? So the applications make requests to the operating system for file reads, file writes, and so on. And the operating system translates them to the block reads, block writes, and so on. So decides which blocks should be accessed and then schedules them. Makes an order of the requests, okay? And serves those requests in that order so that the seek time is minimized or reduced. The total seek time is reduced. So this is called the disk scheduling, okay? So basically, the major job of the disk scheduling is to reduce the seek time. The seek time is time for the disk to move the head, disk head, to the correct cylinder containing the desired sector which we would like to get, okay? The other latency is the rotational latency, but you cannot do anything about that, okay? But you can actually affect the seek time by properly ordering the requests. So we would like to minimize the seek time. The time that you spend, the disk spends on seeking, okay, from one cylinder to another one, depends on the distance, physical distance, okay? So basically it depends from which cylinder, at which cylinder you are at the moment, and to which cylinder you are going, okay? On the way, how many cylinders you are skipping, okay? So that seek distance affects directly the seek time. So you can directly assume that the seek time is a direct function of, linear function of the seek distance, okay? So if we can compute, for example, the seek distance, the distance traveled while serving the requests on the disk, then we can estimate the seek time, okay? So now let's look to the issue more. Several algorithms exist to schedule the servicing of disk input-output requests. We will now talk about those algorithms. So for that, we are assuming, let's assume, we will just use an example over which we will evaluate our algorithms, okay? In this example, assume the disk has many cylinders, okay? A typical disk may have 10,000 cylinders, but let's assume we have a small disk which has just 200 cylinders, numbered from 0 up to 199, okay? So, for example, cylinder 0 can be the outermost cylinder. The cylinder 199 can be the innermost cylinder, okay? All right? So each circle is one cylinder, right? And then what we can have at a given time is we can have several requests for blocks pending. Those has to be retrieved, okay? Where do you think those requests are pending? In a device queue, right? Device is the disk. We have a device queue, all right? There are requests pending. Each request is something like that. Retrieve this block and write into it, or retrieve this block and read into it, and so on. Okay, write into this block or read into this block. Okay, that means each request specifies a block number, okay, into which we would like to perform an operation. Okay, so we can have several such requests pending for the disk. So, do we have such requests enqueued actually? Assume an application would like to read some portion of the file, which is just one block long. Okay. So it will issue a request to the OS. OS will issue a request to the driver. Driver will issue a request to this controller and so on. So at the driver, we will have such a request now. Read that block, X, okay? So the driver will initiate the command, the initiate the IO operation with the disk controller. So the disk controller will try to get the block from the disk. During this may take some time, for example, 20 milliseconds. During this time, that process will be blocked, right? It is now doing disk IO. So that process is blocked. That has initiated the IO, file read operation, for example. So when that process is blocked, why can we have some other request coming? Why do we have many requests pending at the disk queue? Why do you think so? Because when, as a process, when you issue an I/O, let's say you would like just to retrieve one block, okay? You are now sleeping after you issue I/O, okay? So you will not issue any I/O further, right? So while that I/O is actually, so this is just one request. While that request is satisfied, you have to wait, which may take, for example, 20 milliseconds. But we are seeing that there may be many requests pending. How can it be possible? The same process cannot issue another I/O, right? Because it is sleeping now. Or maybe it can do that. It can instruct the OS to read a large portion of the file. For example, you can instruct the OS to read, for example, 100 kilobytes from the disk, which may correspond to 100 blocks. That means now you are having 100 requests at the request queue, okay? This is possible. But do you think that the request queue can include requests from other processes at the same time? So what can happen is that when that process is blocked, another process will be run, right? When that process is waiting for that I/O to be completed with the disk, another process is run. So during this time, another process can issue a read or write request into a file. So that means some other request can be added to the request queue. That process will be sleeping. Another process now can run and issue some request to the disk. Okay? Satisfying each request can take 20 milliseconds, 30 milliseconds. During this time, lots of processes can start running and can issue other requests. Hence, at a given time, you can see the request queue for the disk actually to be quite long. There are lots of requests to be satisfied, lots of blocks to be retrieved, okay? So that's why we can have that request queue not very small, not just including one item, but several items can be there, okay? Several requests can be there. So these requests can be expressed in terms of block numbers. You would like to get that block of the disk. But actually, that can be translated into cylinder numbers, which does matter, okay? So, as a result, what we can do is, for each request, including a block number, we can convert that block number or find out on which cylinder that block is sitting. So then we can consider that request as a request to a cylinder, or as a request to a block on some cylinder. For example, the queue state can be something like that in the disk driver. So what it says is that we have a request for a block that is sitting on cylinder 98. We have a request, another request for a block sitting on cylinder 183. We have another request for a block. We would like to retrieve a block from cylinder 37. We would like to retrieve another block from cylinder 122 and so on, okay? We are just interested in the cylinder numbers, not the block numbers, okay? And because that will affect the scheduling decision, because that is affecting the seek times, the cylinders. If all the requests are on the same cylinder, then the seek time will be zero, right? Because you are already in the correct cylinder, so you can just retrieve all the blocks. You have to just wait for the rotation latency, okay? There only we will encounter rotation latency, but we said that we cannot do anything about the rotation latency. We can just affect the seek time with the disk scheduling. So therefore, we are just interested in the cylinder numbers, okay, for the requests. So assume we have such a request queue, okay, where for each request, we are just writing here the cylinder number for the block that is requested, okay? So for example, that means we would like to get a block from cylinder 124, okay? Now assume also the head, the current disk head, is currently at cylinder 53, okay? So initially we have this setup, okay? At some time instant we can have this system state. Now how can we serve those requests? In which order we should serve those requests? This is the question, okay? And the order can be defined by a scheduling algorithm, okay? So now we will see several scheduling algorithms. One is the FCFS algorithm, first come, first served. The first request that has arrived into the disk queue will be served first, okay? The first request that has arrived will be served first. Let's say, for example, this order here gives you the arrival order of the requests. So this is the first order that has arrived, the request that has arrived, and so on. So that means you will serve the requests in this order. That means you have to first retrieve the block sitting on cylinder 98. So you are on cylinder 53, so you have to move the head to cylinder 98, okay? This will take some time, let's say 3 milliseconds or 5 milliseconds, okay? So then you can retrieve the block from that cylinder, okay? Of course, you cannot retrieve the block from there immediately because you have to wait until the block comes under the head, then you retrieve the block, okay? But we ignore that rotation latency because we cannot change that, okay? So after you retrieve that block, that means you retrieve the block sitting on cylinder 98, you go and serve the next request. What is saying? This is a command, all right, that would like to retrieve, that asks the disk to retrieve block sitting on cylinder 183. That means now the disk controller should issue the command to the disk arm to move the head to the cylinder 183. And then we will retrieve the block sitting there, okay? So after you have served that request, then what we will do? We will serve the next request, which is a block on cylinder 37. So we have to move the head to cylinder 37, right? So the cylinder from cylinder 183, we move the head up to cylinder 37, which will take quite a lot of time, let's say 5 milliseconds, okay? Then we come to that cylinder and retrieve the block sitting there. Of course, it may take some time too, 1 or 2 milliseconds, but we just ignore that for the moment. And then we move the head and so on to serve other requests. So we just move the head to those cylinders in this order, okay? So at this point, we have finished. Okay, so this is time axis. At this point, we have finished serving all those requests. All the blocks retrieved from the disk, okay? And given to the operating system. So the question is, how much did we spend while serving those requests? So the time that we spent is directly proportional. The seek time, total seek time, is directly proportional with the seek distance. Your travel distance. And your travel distance can be computed by just subtracting that cylinder number from that and so on, okay? So basically the length of those lines will be your seek distance, which you can consider as the seek time, okay? So, for example, if you do the computation, the total head movement includes 640 cylinders. You just go over 640 cylinders while serving all these requests, okay? So, therefore, the seek time is that, okay? Or the seek distance is that. Is it clear? So, can we improve that better? So that means here actually we are doing lots of useless traveling, right? You travel to that end of the disk and then you come to here and so on. So actually let me just show what we are doing over a disk, okay? So this traveling means that this disk head is moving back and forth, okay? So this is one cylinder, this is the innermost cylinder, this is the outermost cylinder, you can move between those cylinders. For example, this can be cylinder 0, this can be cylinder 199, okay? You may be at cylinder, for example, 53 initially, you are moving the head here, there, and so on, okay? So what can we do better than this? So assume you are at cylinder 53, okay? So assume all these requests are in the queue at the time that you would like to do a scheduling decision at the driver. Now you are the disk driver, okay? You have disk queue, okay, controlled by you. You are the software, disk driver, and you will now give a command to the disk controller to retrieve a block. And you know that the head, physical disk head, is at cylinder 53. Which command would you issue to the disk controller? Which block should be retrieved? What do you think? 65, right? So basically, this is the closest one, right? So you would do such a request, for example. Give me block 65, okay? So then the disk controller will give you block 65. So assume you have that now. What would be your next command? For which block? 67, right? So now you have a different algorithm, which is called SSTF, shortest seek time first. Basically, you go to the cylinder that is closest, that requires shortest seek time, okay? So we select the request in the request queue with the minimum seek time from the current disk head position, okay? So the current disk head position is 53. If you did not draw that, you now look to the request here and you find the request here, number here that is closest to 53, okay? And you go to that cylinder and retrieve the block from there, okay? So what is the disadvantage of that? SSTF. Starvation, right? So it is similar to SJF scheduling, shortest jump first scheduling. So it may cause starvation because if you always have some nearby request, you will always be busy to serve them. And you will not serve a faraway request, right? So let's go over the SSTF algorithm in more detail. So let's do an example. So this is the current head position. The head, this cat, is physically on cylinder 53 at the moment, okay? And as the driver, you know that this is the disk Q, okay? So as the driver software, now you instruct the controller to move the head to which position? To cylinder 65, okay? So the head is moving there, and 65 is retrieved. And then, as the driver, you instruct the disk controller to move the head to where? To cylinder 67, okay? And the block there is retrieved. And then, as the driver, you instruct the disk controller to read the block sitting on cylinder 37. So therefore, the disk controller moves the head to cylinder 37, and the block sitting there is read. And then, as the driver, you instruct the disk controller to read which block? After this point, block 14, right? So you instruct the disk controller, the hardware, to do that. So the hardware moves the head to that position and reads the block there. And then, as the driver, you give another command and so on. According to SSTF algorithm, this will be the head movement pattern, okay? So you can now compute the total distance traveled by the head, okay? For example, here, between these two points, the head moves how many cylinders? 12, right? Here, two cylinders and so on. Between this point and that point, 53 cylinders and so on, right? You can compute how many cylinders we travel totally, okay? This will be your total seek time. So we have computed that. It makes 236 cylinders, okay? So the number of cylinders that are traveled here is much less than this one, okay? So this seems to be a better algorithm than the FCFS, but of course it has the starvation problem. So can we do better? So SSTF, unlike SJF, which is optimal, SSTF is not an optimal algorithm. Yes?
We can arrange the, all of the requests in a way that two-way is scanned in the
right direction. Exactly. So does it remind you something from real life? Assume you have people waiting for requests, and a machine is serving those requests. What is that?
Yes. Hmm? An increasing order.
Right. Is there a machine in real life that you are using and that's actually working with that principle?
Yes.
What is that machine? Going in one direction and serving the request and then changing the direction. A machine that you are using. It's elevator, right? In a multi-story building, it's going in one direction and taking the people in that direction and then changing the direction. So this is actually also called elevator algorithm. So we will refer it as scan algorithm. It's also referred to as the elevator algorithm, okay? So now the disk arm starts at one end of the disk and moves towards the other end. While doing that, it is servicing the request until it gets to the other end of the disk. Then the disk head movement is reversed and servicing continues in the other direction and so on. This is the basic algorithm, okay? So we will talk about that after the break.